Just south of Beirut, Lebanon, is Damour. Everybody living here today came from Tal al-Zata.
Al-Zatar means in Arabic the hill of thyme. It is in the eastern suburb of Beirut. It is an area of 1 kilometer long. It is a valley, it is not a hill. It is called so, but it is a valley surrounded by many hills. It is an area of 1 kilometer in width and 3 kilometers long. And it was occupied by Palestinian refugees who came in 1948 with some poor Lebanese. And mostly in Lebanon, the poor Lebanese used to live in these areas where the Palestinians, because, you know, with cottages and slum areas, as you call it. The population of the camp was 30,000. 17,000 of them were Palestinians, 13,000 Lebanese. Neighboring to Tal al-Zatar, there was a Lebanese quartal called Ras al-Dikwani. And from the other side, there was a big number of factories, because in this area concentrated about 25% of the Lebanese industry. And it is known that, because here they have workers, I mean cheap manpower in this area, can encourage industrials to have their industries in this area.
Thank you. The cooperation of the students together here help us to return back the smile for on the faces of these children, because most of them have lost their parents. Most of them lose two or three of the sisters and brothers in the battle in Gaza. First of all, Damour is not to us. Damour is for its owners.
Who are the owners?
The Damourians.
Yes.
But when we kicked out from Tel Zatar, we find no place to stay. So we come to Damour, مؤقتاً يقولونها temporary.
You and Dr. Labadi and the team worked in Tel Azata all the way through the period which began with the attack in January 76, the blockade. And the work of the Red Crescent clearly was what enabled the people and fighters of Tel Azata to resist for so long and so heroically. Will you tell the story of Tel Azata from the work of the Red Crescent, from the heart of the camp?
You see, the geographical situation of Tel Azata found in the middle of the right-wing organization's area had put big responsibilities on the Red Crescent Society to exert much effort in building a God hospital with good equipments, because maybe we were expecting such a siege. So they built a hospital there, or we built a hospital there, which costs us more than £1 million. This hospital was, of course, in underground conditions. The capacity of 40 beds, with operative theater, with emergency room, with radiology center, pharmacy, laboratory, good laboratory, and enough or sufficient stuff, medical stuff. But unfortunately, it was difficult for us to have enough doctors there, because it was a dangerous area and many doctors refused to work there. For me and for Dr. Labadi, it was a challenge. And we decided by our own will, to go there. I was there in August, and he came before me 2 weeks. And we have done a study for the social and the medical and the sanitary situation of the camp, and starting putting a plan for the camp, starting from preventive medicine, from sanitary situation, because it was a camp of open canalization, many children playing in rubbish and so on, and this of course makes the sanitary situation worse. So we started from this point, for example, removing the rubbish and cleaning the canalization and giving instructions to the people how to manage. We have a campaign against scabies inside the camp, because you know this scabies, or itching as they call it, it is mostly in such areas because the camp is overcrowded with people. It is small cottages with very narrow alleys with open canalization. Majority of the population is children, you know, the families, most we have the members of the family, the average it is 8 to 10, and mostly they are children. So in these days where we have enough time, we pressed, or we have stress on preventive medicine, on qualifying our personnel. But at the beginning there was a difficulty in personnel, because we haven't enough. So we started our intensive courses of first aid for practical nursing and for operative stuff. And we are proud that our personnel were ex-carpenters, students, blacksmiths, and so on. And within 2 or 3 months, we were able to have about 30 good qualified nurses who helped us so much that we didn't feel that we are only 2 doctors. We work in a power of 20 doctors at that time. And if you know that, we have received or admitted in our hospital more than 6,000 casualties. You can understand that the work of the nurses and the personnel was very great. The first siege was in January, and it was a siege where they prevent any kind of food supply or other means of supply to the camp. And there were battles and fights at that time, and the road opened for a couple of days. And then started the second siege.
You said you treated about 6,000 casualties. What kind of wounds and infectious diseases were you having to deal with during the 55 days?
During the 55 days, we have mostly the war injury, especially the shrapnels, because it was a very heavy and severe bombardment. You know that 60,000 bombs within 2 months in the camp had fallen. Moreover, there was severe diseases just like gas gangrene. We have cases of tetanus. And the most dangerous for us in the last days was the dehydration of the children. You know, the last 15 days, we have only 20% of the water supply. And even this 20% of water supply was from one source, which is very close to the positions of the phalanges. And I know that when the people, when the mothers go by nights to fetch water, they just said to each other, farewell. because nobody knows if he is coming back or not. And we have the martyrs of water. We have a daily average of 15, 17. One day we have 37. Because the phalangists used to throw bombs on this source of water. And in spite of that, mothers, people were trying to get water. One time, they brought me a mother with a bucket of water in her, on her head. And she was a sniper in her hand. But she still holding this bucket of water. And she came to the hospital, and with great difficulty, we could release this bucket because she was very happy that she got some water. And she was not paying attention even to the injury. The most important for her was that she got water. So this was the situation for the water. The last 48 hours, we have no water at all. And we have the last days, we have a daily average of 10 to 12 children dying daily. Mothers brought their children just like that. This is skin and bone in Arabic say. And doctor, what can I do? And I know that they need water. They need milk, they need water. Even this we can't ensure for them. So they, all of them tell me, shall I prepare for him a tube? It was very difficult for me to answer such questions, right? Because I know that they need water. So the problem of water was a striking one. And this put us in a very bad situation because we were not defending inside the camp, not the alleys, not the windows, not the doors. We were defending the people, and especially the children. So what we can do if they are dying in front of our eyes?
How much water were you able to give to those you were looking after in the hospital?
In the hospital. You see, a glass of water has to pass for between 8 to 10 wounded people. Everyone can have maybe one mouthful, and that's all, because it was very rare. And we have to give them water, especially those cases with abdomen injuries. You know, we have no infusions, so we used to give them with a spoon. Every couple of minutes, we give them 2 milliliters of water because they can't eat. They can't. So we give them water by teaspoons every couple of minutes. And this, of course, affects the situation of the wounded greatly. But I say that mostly involved were the children, the small children, because they can't stand the water loss like adults. So we see them, or we saw them vanishing in our eyes. They are dying slowly, or they were dying slowly.
How did you manage for drugs and dressings with a blockade and the siege?
You see, the first 10 days, we were obliged, after the first 10 days of siege, we were obliged to evacuate the hospital for certain purposes. First, the roads to the hospital were very dangerous. The underground conditions without electricity was very bad for the wounds. And the hospital was overcrowded. We were afraid that the hospital would be taken over by the other side because it was in the front. So we evacuated the hospital to another place. At that time, or with this time, with that time, we have a big deficiency in drugs because the great number of wounded, and we were planning to have medical supply to the camp, but we succeeded to have one truck passed in. This is in the first, after the first siege, but we didn't succeed to have the rest of the medical supply. Of course, at the beginning we started our own infusions. We make infusions by ourselves, especially glucose and normal saline when there is electricity. But after that, no conditions of sterilization, no electricity, with the big deficiency in drugs, we started using the hypertonic solutions, water and salt. Of course, we have big deficiency in the medical materials, the gauze, the cotton, for dressing. So we started using the curtains, the sheets, the clothes for dressing, as a dressing material. What helped us is the penicillin, because we had only the penicillin. Even it helped us up to the, I mean, only the last 15 days we have no drugs at all. But we have to that extent penicillin. But what penicillin can do for all these wounds, especially we have severe infections on the chest and the abdomen. We have gas gangrene, we have tetanus, we have head injuries, brain injuries. At the hospital, we were able to do operations, major operations even. But later on, with the loss of the drugs, with the loss of infusions, with the loss of sterile conditions, we were obliged to do only life-saving operations. One time, one of our nurses wanted to evacuate a casualty which was near our emergency center. She ran to that position and suddenly a bomb fell near her. And she had a very big thigh injury. We wanted to, of course, there was an arterial bleeding, with arterial cut. So we wanted to operate here, but at that time we were living the days of the convoys on the International Red Cross. And we were preparing here for evacuation next day. But suddenly the evacuation of the wounded stopped for 5 days, and we couldn't do anything for her. And we lost her.
During the period of January until August, what help did the International Red Cross give?
Interlazatar, nothing.
Nothing?
Nothing. The role of the International Red Cross Interlazatar was the evacuation of 465 wounded in 4 convoys. They didn't even allow the phalangists and the fascists, they didn't allow the International Red Cross to bring anything inside the camp.
With the fearful injuries that you and Dr. Labadie had to deal with, how was it that you were able to carry out operations that you'd never dealt with before?
I graduated a general practitioner and finished 1 year in surgery, because I was specializing, but when the clashes began in Lebanon, I quit my specialization and came back. But of course, I have to do my job as a surgeon, as a dentist, as a gynecologist, as an obstetrician inside the camp, as a pediatrician. I have to do everything, because there was no choice. So we succeeded to do big operations, and we had good results of them. We operated in abdomen, extremities, on chest, and even on brain.
And in the last 15 days, you only had salt and water?
On the last 15 days, we even had no salt and water. Even at the last days, we used to tell the people, the relatives of the wounded, to bring us a bottle of water and a little bit of salt in order that we can do dressing for their relatives or the wounded we had.
How many people in Tel Azotta died before the evacuation?
Before the day of the evacuation, we lost 2,500. And the last day, only the day of evacuation, we lost about 1,000 people. We don't know their destiny till now. But myself, I was a witness, an eyewitness of the massacre. I have seen hundreds of dead bodies, starting from the entrance of the camp up to the museum area. As you know, that day they have 12 control points, and in these 12 control points they used to liquidate mostly the males. And I have seen dead bodies of pregnant women, old people, children, and my nurses, because they shot my nurses in front of my eyes. These are the pictures of them. I will not forget that moment at all. And I don't know what is civilization. Those people count themselves as the representatives of the European civilization in the Middle East. I don't know if the European world opinion agree with that. Maybe there is a new definition for civilization, I don't know. This is a question I ask to the international world opinion.
How were you able to get out of the camp?
I was lucky. I was put to the wall to be shot with my nurses, but suddenly one of the phalangists recognized me. I had operated him 7 months before that moment on his chest, because they brought him to our hospital. It was the nearest hospital in that area. And they recognized me and wanted to save my life. Then they started an argument. One of them wanted to shoot me, the other one wanted to save my life. And suddenly a Syrian officer put an end to their argument. Fortunately, I had operated him before also. So he took me and I started telling him about the nurses, and it was in vain. He told me it is useless to save the nurses. And they were shot in front of my eyes. Of course, the evacuation of the camp was through an agreement by the Palestinian resistance on the other side. And this agreement was sponsored by the Arab peacekeeping forces and the International Red Cross. And they should come next day, on 12th of August at 8 o'clock in the morning, to take the children and the civilians. But at that day, there was a big trick. And the phalangists started heavy shelling in the camp, and they double-crossed the civilians, the mothers and children, and there was a great massacre. Of course, as far as our staff is concerned, they reached us and took us, and we succeeded to take with us 38 heavy wounded patients, because everyone was held, every two of us held one patient. But they killed those 38 with the nurses on that day. And through our investigation, we know that we lost 1,000 people on that day. We don't know their destiny, but I have seen many dead bodies, among them my nurses.
صار ينام الإنسان على الأرض وحط رقبته على لوحة خشب ويقطع راسه.
جابوا السيارة، السيارة من هون والسيارة من هون، ربطوه بالحبال وفلقوه.
جابوا محرمي كانت حبلة مع أولادها، بعدين ضربوها بالسكينة. صار ابنها فز من بطنها وصار يلعبط بالارض.
انا ابني مفقود وجوزي وجوز بنتي، هذه جوزها مفقود. هاي ابنها مفقود. هاي الاخت اربع شباب وابوهن راحوا، هاي الست. هاي كمان جوزها مات. واخوها مات. كل واحد عندنا في عنده مشكلة بحياته، كل واحد. لولا ما هي المصيبة جماعة يعني يمكن كنا متنا زمان، بس أنا مصيبتي وهي عندها مصيبة وهي عندها مصيبة وهي عندها مصيبة، يعني بنشوف كل الناس عندها مصايب مثل بعضنا البعض.
حوالي 652
هون الأخت 14 نفر.
أنا لي شابين.
14 نفر راحوا من فرنسا.
أبو جعفر كمان شباب اثنين مفقودين.
أنا جوز الجريح نزل معي على تحت الدكواني. أخذوه مني تحت الدكواني ونزيفه ماشي. وين الضمير؟ وين الضمير للشعب؟ نزيف وماشي البجامه اللي لابسها بعصريها دم. قال لي ما بدي تنزلي معي على الطريق، لاني انا ما بقبل ان الانعزاليين يذبحوك ويذبحوا اطفالي وانا عم تشوف. ما بدي تمشي معي بالطريق، واخذوه مني على تحت الدكوان. عندي سبع اطفال انا.
احنا كانوا يحاربونا حرب اباده. مش حرب انه اذا نزلنا سلمنا انه خلص عفو عنا، لا بدهم يقتلوا الطفل والمراه والبنت والزلمه.
When you defeated in Talazata?
هزمت وشفت الزعتر؟
هل تعتقدون انه انهزمت الثوره في تل الزعتر؟
لا 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 لا
عفوا هي دائما يعني اي معركه او اي حرب تبتدي من اجل اهداف. فالحرب اللبنانيه كان في من اجل اهداف طبعا. فمشكلة الزعتر يعني شيء معركة من احدى من المعارك اللي كانت تصير. فبخسارة موقع او احد المواقع العسكرية هذا لا يعني انه نحن خسرنا المعركة او خسرنا الحرب. بل بالعكس زدنا صلابة وزدنا ايمان بقضيتنا. وطبعا كمان ارتفعت معنوياتنا بتأييد العالم أو الشعوب الوطنية كان عربية أم عالمية. ارتفعت معنوياتنا بمعارك الزعتر لأنه كان الزعتر فعلا أسطورة، وكما يقال لينينغراد الثانية هو تل الزعتر.
Why do the Zionists, why do the imperialists want to defeat the Palestinian revolution.
ليش الانعزاليين والصهاينه والامبرياليين الامريكاني يتآمروا على الثوره الفلسطينيه؟
هنالك في أوروبا بأنحاء العالم في ثورات قامت وانتصرت وحققت ووصلت إلى هدفها. فبقي بالشرق الأوسط هون ناس كثير بعدها مهضوم حقها، ولا إنسان عم يوصل لحقه، عم تبكي من الجوع، من تعليم أولادها، من مناصبها في الحياة المعيشية. الإنسان ميت هو حي، حقه مش عم... البيت اللي بينام فيه إذا إجا إنسان قال له اطلع منه عم يطلع منه، ليش؟ ما في حدا عم يدافع عنه، ما له حق. فعندما اغتصبت أراضي فلسطين من أهاليها فكانت الفلسطينيين بعضهم أضعاف ضعفاء، ثم قويوا، ثم جابوا سلاح، ثم ترقصت، ثم انتشعت ثورة وتعليم، حتى كبرت الثورة وصارت الثورة تهز العالم. فهنالك الصهيونية أمرت أمريكا أو ألمانيا أو الاتحادات الذي بناصرها، إذا ربحت الثورة الفلسطينية واختلطت وأخذت دولة نحن لا وجود لنا في فلسطين. ثم في شعوب أخرى بدأت تحقق الهدف من وراء الثورة الفلسطينية تأكيدا. فقامت الإنعزالية والصهيونية والإمبريالية وغيرها، فأجتمعوا وركزوا هالشيء حتى يخنقوا الثورة الفلسطينية، لحتى الباقي يفرفط مثل ورق، يعني بيوقع بفرفط من حواليها. الحركة الوطنية بلبنان مخنوقة، قامت مع الثورة الفلسطينية، حيث الثورة الفلسطينية مسكتها حتى تركز لها كرئيسها، حتى الإنسان يقدر يعيش، حتى الإنسان يقدر يعلم ولاده، حتى الإنسان يقول أنا إنسان، أنا مش حيوان في الدنيا، أنا إنسان تيموت. فاجتمعوا على الثورة الفلسطينية لأن هي الثورة الفلسطينية اللي مسكت الشعب هون والشعب مسكها. فصارت الثورات تتسامع فيها بالسعودية، بعمان، بمصر، بأنحاء العالم. فالبرجوازية ما بيوفقها إنه تنتصر الثورة الفلسطينية، تنتصر الشعوب المغتصبة حقوقها. هذا كل الناويين عليه للثورة الفلسطينية حتى يبيدوها انباتت من حواليها الثورات.
هن بدهن جماعة أرستقراطية، يعني أرستقراطية بدهن يعزلوا نفس يعزلوهن هذول الجماعة اللي عم بحرض عم بساعدوا على الجماعة اللبنانية المظلومين. اللي طبعا المسلم خلينا نقولها بكل صراحة كان مظلوم، مضطهد حقه عند اللي سبب التمييز العنصري اللي موجود عند الإنعزالية. يعني ماروني له رتبة، مسيحي له شغلة، له وظيفة، أولاد مأمنين كل شيء. مسلم إذا أي ما له ما في له واسطة، ما في له وظيفة، مضطهد حقه، مظلوم. فلذلك ساند الثورة الفلسطينية من أجل وجود حقهم. والإنعزالية خافوا على خافوا من تل الزعتر لأنه امتدت جذوره هناك وكان تجمع فقير كثير التفوا حواليه. لهالسبب هذا ما حب يكون تل الزعتر، حب القضاء عليه من أجل تقسيم لبنان لأنه كان واقف بطريقة تقسيم تل الزعتر.
والآن سيشرح الأخ أبو جعفر قصيدي عن مزاجر عن مجازر تل الزعتر وبطولات مقاتلين تل الزعتر وما جرى في تل الزعتر من جوع وعطش وتجريد وتشريد وقتل وذبح. قال فيها: تل الزعتر يا تل الصمود بوجه الغزاة الجردوا عليك جرود، فضل أبطالك لا تلب أخلاص ما همهم لا قذيف ولا برود، من أول رصاصة لآخر قذيف كنت أنا بالمعركة موجود، مثل ما صار عم بحكي المعارك كلام الصدق ما بدها شهود. أول يوم 20,000 قذيفة نزلت على الأهالي وعجنود، وثاني يوم 15,000 قذيفة على المخيم تشوف الحرائق والدخان صعود، وثالث يوم خفت شوي لكن وقفوا لاستراحوا لردود، كل ما اشتدت أبطالنا تقاتل بهمي علي مثل أشبال الأسود. أدر شهرين الموت تنكة مي من صبح العشي والزاد صار عندنا مفعول جف لسان الطفل من العطش ويقول يا بي واموت وعدو ان الصبح بيعود والولد عند الصبح يسأل وين بي يجاوب المسؤول ابوك مفقود والبنت تسأل امها وين خي قالت لها بالمتراس موجود بدافع عن الشرف والناموس يا بني والعمر بضع ساعات محدود يا ما شباب راح الضحية استشهدوا لا يدخلوا جنات الخلود ما في مرة إلا تقول يا بني ونور عيني ودمعها يجري على الخدود ولا في بنت إلا تقول يا خي وعبيت اخوتها لبستها وما في شيخ عاد عنده عزايم قوي عند ما شاف ابنه على ارض ممدود انا الي شبينا عزم النور عيني وكنت فيهم بالادب محسود طلعتهم مثل شمس المضي وعن خدودهم طبطف سلال ورود يحيى فتح وفوزي ديمقراطي اثنيناتهم تقول جوزف هود طلعوا بالجبل ما عادوا علي ومن يومها انا حزنان مكمود يا رب يا رحمن ردهم علي ورد كل غايب لا صرتوا يا معبود هذا امر الله عليك وعلي رب الدالي وما نقطف العنود يا رب يا رحمن اسمع دعانا ورد علينا ومحي ليالي السود اوف يا زعتر راهن العالم عنصرك وخذ في المعركة بقوة عنصرك شعوب الحر بارك لك عنصرك لكن خانوك حكام العرب اوف يا زعتر العالم عليك
What have you learned from Tell Al-Zaatar that you didn't know before?
I believe more in my problem now. I believe that it is not enough to be a doctor. Sometimes you have to go deep in the social problems of your people and I have to stand on the first frontier or line of the people, my people, and that it is not enough to dream of having your problems solved. You have to struggle for them.
Oh, Liberate Palestinian. يتجدد في وطن الأجداد ساب الولاء أبد الأبد أتجدد في وطن الأجداد فأنا والمصر فأنا والمصر هو شمس الأحرار
Something. Where do you come from?
من أي بلد أنت؟
قضاء صفصاف فلسطين.
Can you tell me about your home in Palestine?
تقدر تحكي لي عن بيتك بفلسطين؟
بيتي بفلسطين كان مأسس من 6 غرف. وكان عند أبوي غنم. وكان عنده بارود حطيتها بين البنات أحسن من الفرنسيين يسرقوا له هي وقت الحاجة كان يظهرها ويحارب فيها عن عائلته وعن شعبه وكان قدام بيتنا حائل فيه مزرعة فيه خضار مندورة وخيار وكوسة وكزبرة
Have you ever seen your home in Palestine? عمرك شفت بيتك في فلسطين؟
لا بس أنا كان جدي يحكي لي هذا الكلام.
Yeah, what is that gun you've got? هذه البارود اللي معك شو اسمها؟
كلاشينكوف.
It has a lot of bullets. إلها كتير طلقات.
30 طلقة.
Why are you doing military training? ليش عم تعملي تدريبات عسكرية؟
علشان لما أتدرب أصير مقاتلة نرجع وحرر فلسطين وهم مش بلادنا إن بلادنا فلسطين المغتصبة مع الصهيونية والحرب طويلة وصعبة انتيش بيوم سنين والعدو ما بفرق بين صغير وكبير وبتمنى أكون مثل هالأطفال أطفال الدنيا اللي بيرقصوا وبيغنوا وبيعملوا حفلات ومشاوير بروحوا لكن الصهيون لكن العدو ما بيرضى وبنت عمي اجت عليها غارة صهيونية وماتت وهي لا بتعرف عن سلاح ولا اشي وانا غصب عني حملت سلاح وعشان بنت عمي الثاني احارب واحمي نفسي وبنت عمي اللي عايشه واخواتي ورفقاتي ونفسي
Can you tell me who your enemy is?
تقدري تقولي لنا مين العدو تبعك؟
الصهاينة مش اليهود، اليهود دين سماوي والصهاينة هي حركة عنصرية استعمارية هذا فطرت الشعب من أراضيه
I've heard politicians from a number of countries say that Palestinians can go to another country, not Palestine, to another Arab country, for instance, Lebanon. What do you think?
I not take another country, another Palestine, my homeland. Because my fathers and my fathers were lived there, where, and I don't leave my homeland.
But for instance, Lebanon's a very beautiful country, isn't it?
No, I shall take Palestinian my homeland, not another.
Selma, what would you do if you saw a wounded Israeli soldier?
إذا شفتي جندي إسرائيلي مجروح شو بتعملي؟
إذا شفت جندي إسرائيلي مجروح بعالجه وبأسره وبحاول أفهمه عن القضية الفلسطينية وبفهمه إنه الشعب الفلسطيني هو مثل باقي الشعوب يعني له حق إنه ياخذ له حق إنه يكون له أرض وإنه يكون له وطن مستقل.
But what if the wounded Israeli soldier tries to shoot you, tries to kill you?
إذا حاول هذا الإسرائيلي الجريح يقتلك مثلا شو بتعملي؟
ساعتها بيكون هذا مش جريح، ده بيكون مقاتل يعني مثل بيقولوا ضبع كاسر.
اخذ الهدف جيد.
وانا
workshop is special for the revolution. The workers here are fighters. They are not ordinary workers. They are ready to fight. One fight must be, and they work. One work must be. The workers here are like brothers. They need money. That's not the purpose. But they do not work for the purpose of money. They can work in other places, but they prefer this place because this place. Here the money are not the purpose. The purpose is the struggle for Palestine.
يعني هون العمل هون كمان مثل يعني أماكن شعبية هون الآن بيختلف عن أماكن الباقي هون أماكن شعبية بتختلف عن أماكن الباقي.
طبعا هون أول شيء الواحد بيشتغل مؤسسة تابعة لأبناء شهداء فلسطين. شو معمل إنتاج؟ طبعا الإنتاج هذا وين بيلحق لأسر شهداء فلسطين؟ وبصير يعطي يعني العامل حقوق كل شيء تمام.
هون بعمل هون لانه وجدته افضل مكان لإلي انه اعمل فيه وبين اخواني.
Says if he works here because he finds it the best place to work between his brothers and comrades.
What do you like best about this workshop?
اكثر شيء بفضل بالعمل هون بهالمصلحه.
أكثر شيء بفضل هون مش بس حتى يعلمونا معلم الجارة حتى بناء جيل مستقبل حتى يحرر فلسطين.
He says that here he first learns a profession, then he can build a new generation fighting for Palestine.
How old are you?
I am old.
14 years old. Clothes for all the warriors and for the summit shops. Ordinary clothes. There are summit workshops in all the camps, making furniture for the schools and the houses and the hospitals, handbags and things of leather, doing earn works, everything. We are nearly all from families of martyrs.
This one comes from Jaffa. And this one comes from Haifa. And this one from Bethlehem. And this is Jerusalem. And this is Halim. And this is Ain Gazel. Tul Karim. Ramallah. And this is Gaza. And this is Gaza. All these stitches from all these towns in Palestine. And recently, the Zionists made up an exhibition and they took it over to the United States. And they showed all this work from all these regions in Palestine. And they said this was Israeli culture.
Thank you.
Commander Salah, what does today, May the 15th, mean for you?
May the 15th is a strategic step in the Zionist plan to take Palestine from her real inhabitants, I mean the Palestinians. The conspiracy against our people didn't start on May 15th. It started earlier than that, many years before May 15th. But on that day, they realized their dream, and they kicked out the inhabitants from Palestine. To us, it's the beginning of a tragedy. We celebrate May 15th every year to emphasize and stress on the fact that although we've been away from our country for many years now, but yet we are more determined to go back now than ever.
Why do all your united leadership insist again and again that Zionism is a threat to every ordinary peoples in the world?
It's because Zionism is a racist movement. It's the same as the Nazism. Nazism was not a threat against the Jews themselves or the Jews only. Nazism was a threat to the whole world, the humanity. It was a bad event in the history of man. This event is repeated. That's why Zionism is not a threat to the Arabs only. It's a threat to the Jews themselves. Zionism is dangerous to Judaism itself. It's a racist movement. It seeks what differentiates the peoples of the world. While we are in a time where we seek what unites the peoples of the world, not what separates them. What makes a certain people superior to other people. So Zionism is a racist movement. It's the same as Nazism. There is a misleading propaganda, Zionist propaganda, which presents Zionism as David and we as Big Goliath. While the truth that we are David, they are playing the role of Big Goliath. The Jews were oppressed, that's true. They've been annihilated by the Nazis, that's true. But now the Zionists are applying the same means. They are annihilating our people. They are oppressing our people. Little David has grown up. He's no more little David. He's armed to teeth with phantom, with the napalm. The oppressed turn to be the oppressor now.
لما طلعنا من فلسطين مش هيك منخبر اليهود تحتل البلد هاي نهرب على الثاني تحتل هون نهرب عن الثاني لحتى طلعنا على بنت جبيل
انا كنت عندي طرشات وكنا بنت جبيل وطلعنا صارت الطياره تحوم علينا تضرب علينا النام هيك كانوا العنزين غنميه معاي فقدتهم ملكيتهم راحوا صرت بحد الجبل هيك بالحجر والطي وهي تحوم الطياره فوقينا
هاي من وين الطياره؟
الطياره لليهود
اسرائيليه
اسرائيل
شو كان الانجليز يسووا
لك؟ الانجليز بقى يجي يكون نفوت هون نروح نفوت نلاقي كان ما فيش يهود انت بستنى هون نروح نلاقي اليهود نفوت ينزروا النفخ يضربوا فينا كل طويل عمر طين في هذا يهزم هيك وهذا يروح هيك شرتعنا عن بعضنا يعني شرتعنا عن بعضنا
استحدوها اليهود عملوا صفوا الشباب 100 شاب قال لهم تعب بحشوا كل واحد قبره بايده بالطنطورة القبر بحشوهم الشباب خلصوا المية واحد صفوهن اليهود وأعطوهن كله صاروا يسحبوا وحطوا كل واحد بحش قبره
حطوا
بقى. Here in Lebanon there are 550,000 Palestinians. Most of them live in the camps. In Beirut there were 7 camps. After the war there are now 4. In the whole of Lebanon there are 17, and there are Palestinians dispersed all over the world.
No, this is before 3 or 4 years or 5 years. All the houses like this before the revolution. But when the revolution is began with our people, with our youth, they change everything here. The houses, the minds of people, the streets. Our street like was sand, not like this. This is also new.
Sand and
water. Yes, sand like this. Yeah. Sand and water and every dirty, the dirties are everywhere.
When did you start the breeze block building?
When?
Yes.
In 1969.
Mm-hmm. By the end of May 1948, 300,000 Palestinians had been made refugees. By the end of that year, another 700,000. In less than 12 months, 85% of the Arab population of Israel had been expelled. Then came the bombarding of the Suez Canal and more expulsions. In 1967, after the June War, another 450,000 were made homeless.
She speak about the treatment of the British, of the English soldiers in Palestine.
The treatment of the Arabs.
Yes. The treatment of your country when they are yield our country.
Yes, the treatment, the British.
Yes.
How the British treated the Arab people.
She said that in the first they took our beans and our flour and our eating, our food. And they killed our men and our sons, and they also took our land and give it for the foreign people who are Jewish.
And when you left Palestine in 1948, did you come straight to Beirut?
You mean direct to Palestine? جيت دغري على بيروت ولا
جينا عطر شيحة عدنا 6 شهور لما طلعوا عطر شيحة ضربوها طلعنا على رماش ومن رماش جينا على بيت حون من بيت حون جينا على سور من سور لعنجر ومن عنجر لطرابلس
She said when they leave Palestine, they come from her country, Kabrish, from Kabri, to Tarshiha. Then from Tarshiha to Huli.
Irmesh.
Then to Irmesh. From Irmesh to Anjar. From Anjar to Trablus. From Tripoli. From Tripoli to Beirut. 7 countries she had passed by them.
And now, how long has your family been here in Bush Barajni?
It does not in Bush Barajni.
22
years. Also, here is the flower.
Look what right here. Right, Fateh.
Oh, yes, Fateh. Here. At the door.
Oh, yes.
Yes, Fateh. Yes, Fateh. Yes, Fateh. Yes, this is the zinc. Yes, this is the zinc. And look at the windows. Look at this. It's when they began to kill us, we hide here. Thousands of children sleep here from killing.
How many shelters did you build in this camp?
About 12.
For how many children?
How many children? About 40,000. Our life is too miserable, but it is too powerful. Look, we are also trees. Yes, also trees. Look. The Palestinian man like trees too much. Like to plant everything and everywhere. In sand, the earth, in good earth, in bad earth, but by his hand, he can make it good.
Mm.
They say the Palestinian revolution was born in the camps. A nation was born in the camps.
Small store in our camp for selling clothes.
Moi, je considère que tout ce qui s'est passé au Liban, ça a été une intervention du communisme international chez nous. Parce que nous étions un des pays les plus heureux au monde. Notre paysan, notre ouvrier, nos lois sociales, nous arrivions à nous rapprocher des pays les plus évolués au monde. Malgré que nous n'ayons pas de richesses naturelles, ni pétrole, ni sous-sol, nous avions réussi à faire de notre économie la meilleure économie du Moyen-Orient. Mais et le Liban était le seul pays dans tout le Moyen-Orient où il y avait cette liberté, il y avait cette démocratie. Dans aucun pays arabe, vous ne trouverez la démocratie et la liberté qu'il y avait au Liban. Et naturellement, peut-être ça gênait le communisme international qui a voulu faire sauter ce régime pour nous aligner au régime communiste. Et nous autres, nous avons considéré que le régime communiste et le régime social pour un pays qui a sa richesse, qui tire sa richesse de l'initiative privée et des capitaux investis au Liban, cette richesse qui est le capital, qui est l'initiative privée et les capitaux étrangers ne peuvent pas aller avec ni avec le communisme ni avec le socialisme. Alors malheureusement, nous avons eu à lutter contre le communisme international. Et je crois que nous avons eu le dessus malgré la force extraordinaire qu'avait le communisme international. Et je crois que nous avons été les seuls à battre le communisme international au Liban. Vous savez que j'ai commencé ma vie, moi, comme sportif. J'étais le capitaine de l'équipe de football, j'étais le président de la Fédération libanaise de football. Et comme tel, nous avons eu à assister aux Olympiades de Berlin en 1936. Eh bien, je ne vous cache pas que j'ai été impressionné par la discipline qu'il y avait, et par la tenue, et par le sens national. Maintenant, cette impression n'a rien à voir avec la doctrine nazie, ni avec la doctrine hitlérienne, et avec la doctrine... nous avons, comme je vous disais tout à l'heure, c'est un des partis les plus démocrates dans tout le Moyen-Orient. Et je vous disais tout à l'heure que pendant ces 30 dernières années, par exemple, entre 1943 et 1970, certainement, nous avions réussi à faire de ce pays un pays modèle, et je le dirai en toute modestie encore, un pays modèle pour le monde entier. Et c'est malheureux que la gauche internationale, qui se sert de toutes les idées, de toutes les choses mystiques, par exemple, elle s'est servie de la justice sociale pour s'introduire, Quel est l'homme raisonnable, quel est l'homme juste et honnête qui ne soit pas pour la justice sociale? Prenez par exemple le cas de la question palestinienne. Ils se sont servis de la question palestinienne pour s'introduire ici.
La guerre chaude au Liban est terminée, mais la guerre chaude dans la région n'est pas terminée. Nous ne pouvons dire que la guerre est terminée au Liban avant que le problème israélo-palestinien ne soit complètement résolu et avant que la résistance palestinienne ne soit totalement désarmée au Liban.
Les gardiens de Cèdre est un parti militaire et politique. Les causes de la guerre, on les a expliquées c'était la horde palestinienne qui sont venues au Liban pour prendre le Liban des Libanais et que nous avons décidé de détruire ces hordes pour ne pas être détruits. La guerre n'est pas terminée, puisque les Palestiniens sont encore sur nos territoires. Le Liban Sud est sous leur domination. Comme nous avons libéré une très grande partie du Liban, nous allons libérer le reste. Et nous continuerons la lutte jusqu'à qu'il n'y ait plus aucun Palestinien sur notre territoire. Pour nos slogans, qui étaient un peu durs pour tout le monde, mais une fois qu'ils comprennent la cause de cette guerre, ils nous comprendront. Aucun Libanais sur le territoire libanais qui n'ont pas voulu quitter, nous avons décidé de les détruire. Et à chaque Libanais de tuer un Palestinien et aucun Palestinien sur terre. Pourquoi détruire les enfants et les vieux? Les enfants avant les vieux, parce que cet enfant qui a 5 ans, dans 10 ans, refera la guerre à mes enfants. Et nous sommes obligés de défendre au moins nos enfants. Donc, qu'il y ait un enfant à moins, ce sera déjà une perte et un bénéfice de côté de nos enfants, à moins faire la guerre plus tard. Pourvu que nous finissons avec tous les Palestiniens sur notre territoire, et même sur tous les terrestres, c'est mieux. On n'a pas détruit tout ce qu'on possède, nos banques, nos établissements, et tout ce qu'on possédait. Chacun de nous possédait pas mal de millions de livres, qui les a détruits par lui-même, ce n'est pas pour arrêter la guerre tant que le Palestinien est là. Nous continuerons cette guerre jusqu'à la fin et nous la gagnerons parce que nous avons le droit et nous défendons notre peuple et notre patrie. I explain English, we will continue the war still and any Palestinians in our land. We destroy everything. Our banks, our office, everything we have is destroyed by ourselves, not to stop the war and all the Palestinians still in our country. We will continue it to the last Palestinians people in our land.
The fascist supported by the imperialism, by the foreign forces, were aiming to crush the existence of the Palestinian, not to let us have the right to fight against our enemies. They were aiming to crush all the rights of the Lebanese people also in this country. When we were fighting against them, we were fighting for the benefit of the Palestinian existence, for the benefit of the Palestinian struggle, more than that, for the benefit of those poor people, of those who were suffering too much in their life. They were having any right to live an ordinary way of life. For that, they were supporting us. We were expressing their feelings in our fighting, and therefore they stood beside us, and they fought beside us.
So, this is not the matter of Christians and Muslims, but as I am telling you, it is a conspiracy against the Palestinians and the Lebanese. And Israelis behind it, and as I have mentioned before, the CIA is against it, or is behind it, and they were planning together for this crisis or this confrontation which had been done in Lebanon. In any case, in spite of what have been done, we were at the Palestinian Revolution against it, but we were obliged to carry on this confrontation to defend our camps. from this very hard attacks. And you see what have been done to Tell el-Zaatar and Kisra Basha, these two camps. And then an example, they had been completely demolished and thousands of our people had been killed only in these two camps. But if we have to give another details, you know that we have great losses. But besides, we have also very important experiences after what have been done. This relation between us and the masses, the Lebanese masses, is very important for them.
They have to live and fight everything which prevents them from living. This is the smallest thing that they have to do. They fight against all the bourgeoisies and with the Palestinians because they have to do this. They are workers, poor people, miserable people live here in Shia. They have many, many rights the government has to do, but the government don't give them anything of that. For that reason, and for many other reasons, they fight in this country, and they have to fight everybody who stops in their way for a living. Here in Shia, we find the workers, the jobbers. They have
these are all Lebanese workers, Lebanese
families.
Yes,
they are all Lebanese. They are all Lebanese. This is Lebanon here in Shia is Lebanon.
Not the Lebanon of Jemaya.
No, not the Lebanon of Lebanon. Never, never and never.
A lovely place to spend the weekend. Beirut is only half an hour away. And Damour is only 10 minutes. And Israel's only 70 miles away. Nice houses. The first one belongs to the Makawi family. And next to it, the Rendur chocolate family. And there's a third house. It belongs to Kamisha Moon and his two sons, Danny and Dory. Que penses-tu? Allons-y. It's very nice. But when the blockade on Beirut was lifted by the Palestinian Revolutionary Forces and the joint Lebanese National Forces, some people came in and left a message on the fireplace of Kamisha Moon, and it said, "This house was built with the money of the people, and it'll go back to the people." Entering South Lebanon. This checkpoint is controlled by the Lebanese Arab Army. This is the section of the army that split and joined the progressive Lebanese forces in the Palestinian Revolution. From now on in South Lebanon, the whole country is under the control of revolutionary command of the progressive Lebanese forces and the Palestinian Revolution, headed by Fatah. From now on, everything is different. A property which was sold to the last owner, the present owner, for £12 million, and includes a little weekend cottage and 150 acres of citrus groves. 18 months ago was the last time that the present owner was here. Isn't that right?
No.
He wouldn't pay compensation to the laborers who were here. So, since he wasn't here, the laborers occupied the cottage and have continued to work in the farm and on the citrus groves, keep the lawn up and meticulously keep everything in order until these questions are settled.
Before the guerrillas came to this region of Lebanon, it was absolutely dictatorship. Suppose a guest come to you, to your house. After a few minutes, you will find the police or detectives. They come and they take the guest to the military camp and they will send him away. If you want to open a radio on any station, you are not allowed to do so, particularly at the time of Nasser or any revolutionary country in the Middle East. They will come and they will listen behind the door.
The fascists, when they make their press announcements, not only begin with saying that it's the duty of every Lebanese to kill a Palestinian, but that the case that they try to make out is that the Palestinians have come into Lebanon, and particularly into South Lebanon, to take everything over, that it's the Palestinians who are causing all the troubles, and of course the purpose of the Israeli shelling and the fascist shelling is try to frighten and panic the South Lebanese villagers and farmers into calling for the removal of the Palestinians, but that hasn't worked. It's the other way around. And the reason it hasn't worked, as such strategies have never worked, they never worked in Vietnam, they never worked in the African countries, and they're not working here either, starts from the situation that ordinary people are really living in. There are about 500,000 people living in South Lebanon, and at least half of them came down south in the course of the last 2 years during the war in Beirut. There's virtually no industry at all, about 500 jobs in the oil company, another 1,000 jobs in various forms of transport, about 500 workers who work in clerical jobs in the banks and so on. But apart from that, to make a living in South Lebanon, you have to be working either in tobacco or in the citrus fruit production. Now, if you're a farmer working in tobacco, and there's about 30,000 families so dependent upon planting and selling tobacco to live, you start off from the fact that even though you have some of the best soil that's available, either in the mountains or lower down, but even if you've got that soil, you have to get a license. Who do the licenses belong to, and who does the land actually belong to? The land belongs to a few landowners, most of whom live abroad. If you're going to use that land as a farmer, you have to get a license, and you have to pay the absentee landowner 10,000 English pounds, 50,000 Lebanese pounds, in order to have a license to work it. To get that kind of money, you've got to go to the banks. And the banks charge anything between 12 up to 24%, and most of the tobacco farmers have to pay around 20% interest. And then you have to sell your tobacco. And all the farmers here, up until the last 2 years, had to sell their tobacco to the government, and the government sold it at the lowest possible prices. So the tobacco farmers were having to pay in order to work, and were losing money when they sold what they'd worked for. About 15,000 find their jobs working in the citrus orchards, 3 months of the year. Many of them migrant workers coming in, living in barns, in whatever's made available. And that's it. 500 fishermen, the whole of the coast of South Lebanon. When the fishermen went to the government 2 years ago and asked to be given a loan at decent interest rates so that they could set up a fish processing plant, they were given the thumbs down. If you look at the farmers working in the fields, they're working with plows that belonged to 2,000 years ago. When an old man in Taibe talked to me, he told me how he and a number of other farmers in the area went to one of the big landowners, Kamal Assad, who owns most of the land, in fact, in South Lebanon, and they asked him if he would build a school in one of the villages. And Kamal Assad's answer to them was, "I'd rather have a camel than have a school. A camel's more use to me than educating any of your children." And that's why the South Lebanese farmers, the South Lebanese families,
have not panicked, and they've not betrayed the Palestinians, but they've turned to the Palestinians and resist in the fiercest possible way the attempts of the fascists and the Israelis to destroy what is being built here.
Regardless of whatever criticisms we might level against the Palestine Liberation Movement, still represents the movement of the Arab masses. It is the only hope in my mind to produce a revolutionary movement in the area. At the present time, it is concentrated in the south. The south is an area where we can build our revolutionary base. Due to political circumstances, there is no authority there. Authorities, wherever they might be, are counter-revolutionary. Now this is the area where we can really develop our institutions, build our forces. This is one thing. Second thing, we are a national liberation movement at the present time. National liberation for us means we want to liberate our country, which is Palestine. We are on the border of Palestine in the south. Anywhere else, we will be too far away from Palestine. On the struggle for Palestine, we can mobilize our people, who are mainly concentrated in the camps, who could see their land right across. It will give them the drive to rally around the movement. The so-called South in Lebanon is nothing but an extension of the Upper Galilee of Palestine, geographically, ethnically, and historically has been always one and the same part through history. The Upper Galilee extends from in Palestine, from the road linking Acre to Safed, all the way to the Litani River. This is one block of mountains, and it is one and the same area, the same people. For me, as my name indicates, Shufani, I come from this area near Sidon, Saida. My family lives both sides of the border, half of which is Lebanese, other half is Palestinian. So how could I recognize a border, a line that was drawn in, I think, 1926 between two imperialist powers, French and the British at the time, to split one clan into two halves? This is totally unacceptable to me.
Arce!
بسرعة.
Last week it became clear that there's the possibility of a big attack here on the south. What do you think is the objective of this sudden build-up by the Israelis behind and with the Kafur front? What is the military objective?
First of all, the Israelis always had their dreams of getting hold of the south to get the need of water from the Litani. And they would support any power that would collaborate with them and that would enable them to realize that dream. This is number one. Secondly, if the Lebanese front get hold of the south, that means a great part of the Cairo agreement would be cancelled. That means, why should they argue about the Cairo agreement when they took the whole south? Their main aim is to uproot our existence in the south. That would give the Lebanese front, that would give them more cards, and in the interior settlement in Lebanon. And that would help them to go on the scheme of dividing Lebanon. So, and on a larger scale, that would give the Israelis more cars in Geneva Conference if it takes place this year. I mean, we would go there weaker. They would go there stronger. That's why they insist on attacking the south or supporting the Lebanese front to attack the south. Although they failed for about two or three times, now they are preparing for a major attack, thinking that that would enable them to get hold of the south.
3 times every day, sometime every day, 3 times. Every day, all night. About 50 bombs, 60 bombs, all night.
What kind of bombs are they?
From Israel. Mm. From Israel is coming. Every time, from Israel. All houses, 175.
They have their reasons to apply such a scheme. Menachem Begin said it once, that after the massacre of Deir Yassin, their troops went through Palestine as a knife into butter. It was easier for them to get hold of Palestine after each massacre, because that would scare the people, that would make the villagers run away, and that means their job in occupying the Arab villages was easy.
When they entered the town, they banged on the door and he asked him to raise his hands. I didn't raise my hands because I didn't understand. So he fired. He told him, why are you firing? He told him, where's the clashing? With very heavy Arabic. It's not Arabic. He told him, clashing, there is no clashing. I have only the stick.
So I understood
he's not Kataib or fascist. He must be an Israeli. Because his Arabic was very heavy, broken Arabic.
الجماعة كان أحجبها والمسؤول من هالبلد هالمسؤول من هالبلد استكنها
There was no armed presence here, except from the village itself, the people's visit of the village itself. The war was in Beirut first. When it was quite in Beirut, they started here in the south. They started shelling, continuous shelling, so a lot of people were forced to leave. Now we're just a few numbers here. The Qatar fascists came here. When they arrived here, through the slaughtering and the things they've done here, people ran away.
This is the town of the deputy speaker, isn't it?
Yes, it's the hometown of Kamal Asad, deputy speaker of the parliament for a number of years. The walls are cracked through that shell also.
And what do you think of Kamal Asad?
No. Shura Yak be Kamal Asad.
Huh?
Shura Yak be Kamal Asad.
كل عمره سيدنا وبعدين صورت له آلاف سالفة شو معنى؟
All the time.
صار حادث بالأول.
We all the time we voted for him. And this is hard to.
لما ولش حاط له كان بيي.
If he.
أما خيي ما ولش حاط ما كان حدا فتح البلد.
He said if he didn't support what's happened here, the fascists or the Zionists wouldn't have been able to enter this village.
وين خربوا له داره؟ بدو عادي يشفع على البلد.
Said, you know, when they blew up his house about the beginning of the Lebanese Civil War because of his stand, political stand. So he said it's like a personal revenge he had, even if it's home, his hometown. He doesn't mind sacrificing it for his own revenge.
I mean, the villagers blew up Kamal Asad's
yes,
house.
The citizens of this village blew up his house because he stands up for a feudal leader that owned the land, the houses, the people.
للجنوب لمنطقة الجنوب تيجي اسرائيل تحط فيها عبوات ناس وتطيرها يموت عالم ما يموتش عالم هي ونصيبها العالم اذا بتموت او لا
صاروا
مغرقين جنة
هاي غير موجود لأنه الإسرائيليين بمنعوا هذا العمل بتضطر كل البحرية يعني المجموعة كلها بتصيد في منطقة صغيرة وبهاي الحالة ما بيستطيعوا جلب الكمية الأساسية المطلوبة اللي بيستطيع منها البحرية يعيش أولاده لذلك حتى كل سرحانه بالليل بتكون من اجل يا دوب يطلع ثمن الاكل
بعدين بطلع عشر ورقات العشر ورقات مئة لحمة اليوم مئة لحمة العشر ورقات بالاول اجوا قاموا بدي يعملوا شركه بريتين مشان يحطموا البحر ياخذوا البحر يعني البحر كان للصياد وعيشتهم بالويل وقام شمعون عمل شركه بريتين لاجل انه شلحهم رزقتهم من تمهم من اللقمه من تمهم ليعمل شركه بريتين ويشلحهم عيشتهم شلحهم عيشتهم.
And how did you get rid of the feudal leadership in the union?
كيف تخلصتوا من الزعامه المزيفه او التقليديه؟
قمنا بثوره لحتى تخلصنا منهم، قمنا بثوره.
احدى المواقع الاماميه خطوط التماس مع العدو الصهيوني والانعزاليين يجب ان نتصرف هون بحذر لان هنالك قناصه اسرائيليين وقناصه كتائبيين. صح أننا سنوفر لك كل الحماية من أسلحتنا الإسناد وأسلحة الرشاشة جاهزة الآن، إلا أنه أرجو مرة أخرى أن نتصرف بحذر. بإمكانكم تتفضلوا بس واحد واحد وبحذر، أرجو أن تجعلوا رؤوسكم واطية شوي.
أوكي.
احنا الان امام موقع مدفع ميم دال مباشر امام العدو الاسرائيلي والصهيوني على مسافه حدود 400 متر امامنا العدو الاسرائيلي والصهيوني الانعزالي في كازينو عين ابل. هذا الموقع هو نقطه التماس الاماميه للعدو بشكل مستمر فاي فيصور اذا كان بامكانه يصور.
Yours facing the village of Ain Ebel, that's a Zionist and fascist controlled village. With the building that you can see in front of you is the headquarters of the fascists, their most advanced position. And there they lost a tank last week. There's Israeli and fascist snipers stretched around that building and that position.
يرمي يرمي. خليهم يخسرون على الانجليز 20 30 طلقة.
He's going to answer back again.
Yes.
هرش بدون فالغلبة هذول عرضوا نفسهم للخطر.
نعم. What?
He's saying, the comrade is saying, what's the end with you?
How
is it going to end with you?
Thank you.
عندك خبر من زار.
And how was Hani killed?
He murdered last year on the 11th of April 1976 in Entura Heights in Lebanon while he was filming the struggle between the Palestinian Lebanese joint revolution and the fascist forces.
One of them, we can put him in the first of the lists. But we have others who were very near to me. Some of them are like my brothers, others like my son. Start the march. Don't know who will continue the march with you. And me by myself, I don't know if I will continue this march or not. It's not a picnic. Definitely, it's not easy to lose all these comrades and friends during this march. But as I have mentioned, it is not a picnic, it is a revolution. And we have to pay this price. Maybe it is very high prices. But for the targets, for our aims, for our land, for our people, what we are paying is still less than what is required.
When he died, he was looking for Jerusalem, his country. And I had some earth in my home. I put them on Hani's grave because he liked Jerusalem very much and he died for Jerusalem. So I threw this earth on his grave, that too, because he was unlucky to have this earth in his hand.
Because we have this very strong unity. between all our comrades, all our people. And because we have this people, the Palestinian people, who is ready to give sacrifices for their aim and for their target, to return back to their homelands. They had been kicked out from this homeland. They had been kicked out from this homeland through a very fierce conspiracy. We have a justice cause. We are not against Jews. We are against Zionism. And you remember that the first slogan which you gave? We said that our aim is to establish our democratic Palestinian state where Muslims, Christians, and Jews can live together. Together. And I'm saying now, they are speaking about settlement. And they are insisting to leave this settlement. Okay. I am saying, why to speak about settlement? Why not to speak about to live all together in this homeland? I am offering this by the name of my people. We don't want to harm anybody. And we are insisting to speak frankly to our people. We don't give them lessons to be terrorists or to be fascists or to be Nazis. Without a civilized theory, ideological theory, you can have this victory. And I think that in the future, all the Jews will understand that we are fighting for them too. I can't imagine that without this ideological theory, without this touches, human being touches, we can carry on in our fighting. In this very hard circumstances around us. Without a very strong platform from the theory, we can't carry on. Fascism, Zionism, and Nazism can't push any revolution. It is human touches who can give the victory. And we are teaching our people from this angle and in this channel and nothing else. And we are proud of it. At least we can say that we are freedom fighter. Actual freedom fighter. You can't say a slogan without the without يعني بدون أن تنفذوا على على الطبيعة. Without putting that into practice, you can't. Slogans only? No. Means nothing. Slogans, but practice. Very important. And for this. 13 years of very hard fighting and struggling against Likud as an example, against CIA, against all these huge enemies against us.
Well.
Yes, assassinations inside our occupied territories and outside. Fascism, Nazism, Zionism. are here and we are still fighting because we are in the correct way. And without this, human being touches, you can't carry on in this long and hard march. It is the facts and it is the law in the revolution. And without it, you can't have any victory. You can't arrive your target. And you can't say that you are a freedom fighter without this very clear line between black and white. And we are very careful that our line must be clear and white. So, you see these kids and these flowers. They are speaking with this confidence, with these human touches. And they can't, we can't accept anything far away from that. Perhaps, and definitely, you agree with what I have mentioned. Definitely.
Yes. Thank you very much.
I have sent you because you give this me this opportunity. At least, maybe I am not a good speaker in English, especially, but at least to give me this opportunity to express my feeling, my thoughts for the thoughts of my revolution, the thoughts of my people. I'm definite. All these honorable persons, all this freedom fighter all over the world is standing firmly and strongly with my people, with my cause. Because we are standing in the same trench with them.
يا لولاك ولولا وجودك يا كان الاستعمار ده كتنا.
idea? The people who believe in this idea, and a gun. And in my opinion too, a gun without an idea, ideological theory behind it, it is a gangster.
Real sick.